Reserve time. Radiant Team Ban.
Hello and welcome back to Game 3 between First Departure versus Mineski Esports. And now, as the score is 1-1, forced into this Game 3 off the winner's bracket. The winner of this game will go on to play against Fnatic tomorrow in the bracket, if I'm not mistaken. Yes, they will play against Fnatic. And you know, I'm just hyped about this game. I mean, Game 2 was just not what I expected. It looked like First Departure were about to take it with a clean 2-0. But I'm not alone. My name is Hades. I'm joined by Scanzer. Scan, are you there?
Yeah, of course. I am here. And look at that Mineski. Still don't want to deal with the Oracle and the Beastmaster. I mean, you could say it worked for them in Game 2. Although, while I feel like First Departure's winning Game 1 had a lot to do with the draft, I don't think that Mineski won Game 2 because of draft. I think that, you know, people throwing around that word throw. I don't know if I call it a complete throw, but I do think First Departure were in a very strong position. Things look good for them, and draft-wise, they'd be happy. They ban out the Spectre this time, so that's the hero they didn't want to have to deal with, that kind of inevitability that, you know, being against the Spectre just gives you so much less wiggle room. You mess up a team fight, suddenly Spectre comes in and cleans you up, or you just don't close up the game quickly enough, goes late, suddenly there's a super big Spectre later on. So First Departure will start with their Void again. You gotta expect it's probably a Miracle Void again. And this time won't have to deal with that Spectre.
Not necessarily, because I think First Departure is just not one of those teams where they rely on specific strategies. I mean, yeah, they'll keep certain heroes, but they'll definitely rotate the roles around a bit. So, I mean, it's still too early to tell, but I still have... So my gut instinct, my spidey senses are telling me this could be a Hana Void. It's more likely as Miracle look to probably looks to draft something a bit different this time. They'll take out the Spectre, okay, not wanting to play against that late game hero, but... I mean, okay, Mineski, will we see that draw? I mean, they pick up the Venge.
Oh, it's the same start with First Departure. They start with the Void and the Witch Doctor, and yeah, I think I agree with you. The draw would be a really good ban here for First Departure, because there's definitely a possibility of that coming out. I wonder what the plan is. First Departure so far, both games have found a way to have more than just three cores. First, they had basically five cores. They support sharing the safe lane and one of their cores jungling, and second game, they just had a straight-up jungle axe, and yep, they banned the draw, but... I'm just curious to see how First Departure avoid having two supports this time, because it seems like that's just something that's like in their bones.
No, they'll pick Zeus up the Enchantress and Zeus. I mean,
Zeus is really good against Enchantress.
Yeah, I mean, maybe this is something we could have seen a bit similar. So maybe this game could be a bit of a mix between, you know, Game 1 and Game 2's drops. So the Zeus, I mean, Wedding Crash, yeah, it's okay if he loses the lane with that alt of his, you know, he's always being able to participate in fights, so he's not too dependent on items. But I mean, Mineski, they're switching things around as well. Enchantress off lane for themselves, that could be quite scary. First Departure doesn't have the control.
Mineski's draft looks a lot like last draft is. Their first four picks looked a lot like a push strategy, and then suddenly they're a Spectre. Spectre's banned this time, obviously, and First Departure pick up the Ursa Warrior, which is excellent against the offlane Enchantress in the lane stage, but it's also... it's quite tanky, it's quite difficult to deal with the heroes that Mineski have, and able to run into those fights. I mean, it counters synergy maybe with the Void, but at the same time, we saw some really good Kronos last game where, like, for example, the Axe could stand outside the Kronos and still attack and still call, and if you get those kind of Kronos off, suddenly Ursa and Void is like a combo.
But, I mean, regarding the synergy of these teams, I mean this draft, so far, I mean, Zeus, Void, and Witch Doctor, that I can understand, but Chrono's Spirit doesn't really synergize with the Ursa, so it feels like the Void is just there to catch everyone in the back, as the Ursa just takes care of like heroes like the Enchantress and Invoker. And yep, they will go ahead and ban out the Drow Ranger. These final picks and bans, Odie's been taking out Darkseer as well. I mean, by taking out the
I expect Mineski will probably pick something like a Juggernaut. Again, they want to, like, they had a very similar lineup last game, and then they lost Big Spectre. They probably want something that can fight with their team, but can also go quite late. So, I think the Juggernaut makes good sense to me. And they ban out the Tusk, which they, I guess, expect to be First Departure's last support hero. But I still feel like First Departure are going to run some shenanigans. I don't think there's going to be just a straight up two supports. I mean, Ursa could jungle, to be honest. Ursa, they could do that thing and have two supports in the safe lane like they did in game one.
Iron Talon OP item. But they take out the anti-mage, so... I mean, Mineski, by taking out the Tusk, I guess they feel that this could be a Miracle Void again. With the Ursa mid. It's unlikely. But I mean, like you
I
mentioned, Erzai jungling.
yeah, it's the they're expecting the tests because they're expecting the supports. I'm the
10
only reason I'm
seconds
not expecting
remaining.
something like that is because I, like I said, I expect First Departure to find a way to like get away with a
5
jungler.
seconds
And
remaining.
honestly, Mineski's lineup looks like it has a jungler at this stage too. Probably unless they
Resource
decide
drained.
to, I don't know, run the Doom as their safe lane farmer, which is something they could do. But I can't. First Watch just doesn't seem like the kind of team who lets the enemy team get a jungler and doesn't take one of their own.
Yeah, but okay, I mean, so far from the past two games, I guess you can say they're trying to find a new playstyle. This is something First Departure they pride themselves on, where they're able to adapt to the metas, even if it's not exactly that patch. So, yeah, I still think this it's better chance for Ursa in the safe lane. Maybe the jungling hero comes out last. It's something which they pick for Polasun always. Let's see who else is left. Chen is still available, but I don't think Wilson plays Chen that often.
No, I don't know. It's not a useful jungler. It's a greedy jungler. That's how it works. I wonder what Mineski are thinking here, because to me it feels like Juggernaut fits in quite naturally. It's quite a natural fit with what they're trying to do. It's
10
good at
seconds
grouping up, it's good at
remaining.
fighting, it's good at pushing, but it also has that late game potential. I don't know if
5
they're
seconds
worried
remaining.
particularly about what the last pick for First Departure is going to be and trying to plan around that.
Lion.
And they pick a lion, so it is, yeah, it's gonna be safe lane
Radiant
farming Doom
team
by the looks of
killed.
it. Unless it's a either safe lane farming Doom or safe lane farming Vengeful Spirits. But it's something different. Either way. It could also maybe be the offlane Doom, the Invoker safe lane, and the mid Enchantress, which I have seen them do, but I think against the Zeus it just doesn't make sense. You know, I've seen Vayno playing mid Enchantress, but I just don't think he'd do it against the Zeus.
I think you take the safe lane Doom, you just keep it on the Ursa, that or the Void. That's pretty much the
10
same plan.
seconds
So
remaining.
once you Doom the Void, you kill everyone else. Void doesn't really have much impact
5
after that.
seconds remaining.
See, that's why the Chrono synergy is really important here for First Departure, and I fear that they have been
Resource
outdrafted already,
down.
because the Lion can easily take care of the Void when he gets a Chrono Spear if he doesn't get it like a perfect Chrono. So First Departure, final hero. Alright, think of all the greedy junglers you can find. Are we gonna see that Axe
Well, see
again?
this. If they pick something greedy, then I think they definitely outdraft. That's the thing, because Mineski took a draft that's very specifically not greedy, right? They're using Doom as a core. So I think that First Departure are in a tricky position now, because if they want to go for their natural greedy pick, they maybe draft themselves into a hole. We might have to see Peloso actually playing a legitimate support here, which you said that he told you that he was excited to play support. So maybe, like, did he mean he was excited to play support, like actually support, or he's excited to play support because he's gonna get away with being a core anyway?
I mean, sometimes when he wants to play support, that may not be what, Miracle has in mind, because you gotta remember, Miracle is the drafter and the captain of this team. So what Paulson really wants, Miracle may be thinking something else for him. Maybe he sees something we don't.
And you don't think they get like input during the draft? Is it just like Miracle, what he says goes, kind of final say?
Not at all. Pretty sure no, because I've watched enough lands with First Departure that when Miracle drafts, the rest of the team is just like, okay, and when something surprise pops out, they're like, that's the surprise for this game.
It's just as exciting for them as it is for the
10
viewers.
seconds remaining.
They they're waiting to see.
So who knows? You
Five
know, you never know.
seconds
Maybe he gets some of
remaining.
his inspiration from Twitch. Maybe Twitch says, "Hey, this hero is OP," and he actually tries it out in scrims. You never know. Oh,
Venomancer.
what? That's oh, what?
Venomancer is also really good with the Void. It's also really good with Zeus. And
What?
it's gonna be a jungle Ursa. It's gonna be
It's
a
gonna
jungle
be a
Ursa.
jungle Ursa. Skans, you are right.
I mean,
I don't
and
even
it's
understand anymore.
because they picked Veno as their core, it's maybe still not that greedy, and they get away with it. It's like a very careful balancing act of like, you know, if they'd picked like a greedy one position farmer that does nothing and just farms to come online, like a Morphling or something, then I think it would be like ridiculous. But because it's the Veno, maybe it's actually
Prepare
okay.
for
And so 3 games in a row, Peloso starts with Iron Talon and runs the jungle and hits neutral creeps and. Yeah, it looks like. What? Have you seen that? They're actually playing carry Venge as a result of Mineski, and I don't know if this was their plan overall, but I think they figured that they need to run their Doom into the jungle if the enemy team's going to be running a Ursa in the jungle as well. So it will be both teams running a jungler yet again as well.
This is like fancy drafts coming up from both teams. I'm not sure about you, but sometimes the way Miracle drafts, it feels like I don't even understand the meta anymore.
This is how I feel when I watch Wings. Have you watched Wings, the
Yet.
Chinese team?
Yes.
I never know what on earth they're doing, but they seem to win anyway. So, I mean, they actually like, for me, they're like the strongest Chinese team right now. But
yeah, I think
anyway,
they just need more opportunities. But all right, so here we go. The Miracle support Venomancer, is Wedding Crash.
No, he's not support. He's not support.
He's
carry.
Oh god.
Yeah.
This is scary. So wait.
He's safe lane farming Venomancer. That's.
Oh, this is bad, yeah. Alright, so Lubby back on the Witch Doctor and off lane Hana playing on the Faceless Void this time.
I mean, this is the question in this game. What's a better carry, Venomancer or Vengeful Spirit? Because these are the two safe lane carries.
I guess that will take like a couple of pub games where you want to test it out over who has the better right click.
I actually think that First Departure have a better draft overall now. I don't know, I think Mineski have a scary group up and do something draft. But it seems like none of these games so far. I mean, the first game eventually got decided that way after a long time. First Departure taking the win. The second game, Mineski had a good push strategy, but they didn't use the push strategy. They won by coming back with a Spectre later on. I think if Mineski can put together their push strategy at a good timing, they got a good chance in this game. But even then, to push against Venomancer and Zeus is really difficult. And in terms of scalability, I think First Departure just outscaled them. So I'm really liking First Departure's position from the draft.
So do I, but the thing is, I like Mineski's draft as well, because of the Venge carry. I mean, this is a hero which we've usually seen like Virtus Pro teams like those. They'll pick up the Venge carry, but I like it as well.
Look at that jungle.
Oh, Porthon. Heavily harassed by Jesse Bash.
Like, they're just gonna jungle the same camp together, is that the plan? I mean, the Doom doesn't have an Iron Talon, and Doom is actually not that good at Iron Talon jungling. It's a different kind of jungling, and so there's pressure on the Doom to make sure he gets as much done as the Ursa, who will naturally get a lot of value.
I think he'll lobby. He has the Shockwave. No, why not?
No, it's.
Oh, he could have.
It's quite difficult.
He could have. I mean, lobby was okay before the Tango, before the healing up. He was like at 170 HP. One more right click, one more Shockwave, I believe.
It was quite close. You're right.
Alright, so looking at the CS, well, your Venge is the top of the last hit chart. Venge carry 8-4, but he and Wedding Crash, the Zeus, looks like he will have a much better lane this time compared to his previous Zeus game, where he was just lacking in CS but made up with it with kills. Whew, game is hard.
Yeah, offlane Void, not yet getting that much, getting a little bit of XP, while the safe lane Vengeful Spirits has been last hitting exceptionally well, getting all those creeps.
Oh, and Venomancer, carry Venomancer, killing off Jesse Vash, missed that. Alright, and Venomous Gale. I'm not sure what Jesse Vash was doing there. He shouldn't have died.
Well, he starts the game with no armor. All he bought was boots, but once you Gale'd, your boots become irrelevant, and I think that's really, like, he got caught by Gale, and that was the end of that. He doesn't have any Scorched Earth, doesn't have any armor. Jesse Vash now decides, okay, I'm actually going to just farm my own jungle. And the reason that he wanted to invade is precisely because if he's just farming his own jungle and Ursa's farming his own jungle, the Ursa's going to get way faster value than the Doom and much more relevant value.
Yeah, and I think he realizes that because the position of First Departure, they're playing very passive right now. No real aggressive movements yet. And I mean, Polisson's farming, so all the same. Oh, actually, wait. If he had the Shockwave, he could have killed Polisson.
There's a Scorched Earth. There's a Scorched Earth.
Turn around.
This could be close. It could be
Turn
really
around.
Close.
Maybe? No? What? Sunstrike! I believe, but it's not enough.
Well, Jesse Vash manages to chase Pulisso out of the lane, but there's not a whole lot that Jesse Vash.
This heartbeat is really annoying.
Yeah, it is.
It's like what?
It's one of the most annoying creeps to be against. It's maybe even more annoying than the Satyr.
It's 140 burst damage, 50 mana, it has a very high intelligence pool, so. Miracle is being forced to get healed up by Lubby. Not going to use any of his sustain items. It's Jesse Vash just stares at the mini columns. Off lane, it's actually been very quiet. I mean, it's hard for them to kill off Hana, but they have the doubles. They have the triple disable actually. Maybe they can if they time it right. Oh. So yeah, wait. Bottom lane, they're going to go here on the Raging Potato with coconuts coming up. Polisson, right click him down, and Ursa will find himself a kill. As the lion at top lane, yep, they said they could kill him, and they timed it right.
So it's exactly what you said. Like,
and Enchantress, oh! Yeah. Getting a kill on Miracle. Heartbeat.
As you looked bot, the fights, I was watching top, and it's exactly what you said. The Hex, the stun, and just really well chained, and Void couldn't do anything.
To me, I feel that, I mean, when you're playing Lion, especially against Void, if you can, it's really, really tricky to time, but if you do, it's just so rewarding when you do get the kill. Because with that time walk, you know, it just time walks all your damage away, all the damage done. It can be really, really annoying.
Yeah, it feels very satisfying to shut the Void out of any opportunity to time warp. Well, in the mid lane, there's an attempt here.
Oh, they're
Doom
gonna
Head,
go on
Ember's
him.
Ruin,
and the Shockwave, and the Cold Snap, Sunstrike down, Winning Crash to fall. No, actually misses it. And Jesse Vash is gonna chase him away. He's gonna go full YOLO here behind the enemy tower, and Winning Crash is actually gonna get away.
Jesse Vash has not been in the mood to go full YOLO today. He's been going only half YOLO at most.
Radiant's middle tower is under attack. And that Raging Potato. Slowed by the Benefit Gear, pulls on, Fury swipes, one more right click, and actually no, Witch Doctor gets the kill.
And it's funny, because we're originally talking about like safe lane Ursa, because it's really good against offlane Enchantress, but you jungle the Ursa and it has a similar effect. Anytime you come into the lane, that Enchantress is not safe at all. And the Venomancer Gale is also pretty good against the Enchantress, not in terms of like...
Going on to Hana, they do get the stuns, will it time it perfectly? Yes, they will, one more right click from each, and they will get the kill again. So Hana... Looks like he hasn't learned his lesson. He's still playing around with these two. Very, very strong laning. And over here again, Jesse Vash is TP to the bottom this time. He wants to have some fun with Miracle. As Raging Potato, he does not have to creep. Only a level 3 untouchable.
Yeah, but here's the Ursa and the Witch Doctor. They're gonna catch Jesse Vash and he's okay, Witch Doctor doesn't get the stun off. I think if you get the stun off on the Witch Doctor there, the Doom could be dead.
Oh, Jules is at perfect CS, he's at 40 last hit, and Invoker is at 30, and you can see everyone else is just trailing behind. Your Zeus just not having the best of farm, but over here, oh, Hana getting stunned up by Kar. Alright, so...
I just think the damage output represented from First Departure as the game scales though, it's really, really good. Honestly, the Venomancer Zeus is like an old school cheesy combo, it's just poison everyone, get them low, Zeus uses ulti, and Zeus has got the spam, the Witch Doctor ulti, the Ursa going in front. It's actually such a good strategy with the Void, where often the issue with the Void is lack of damage, but all four of the other heroes have huge damage outputs on the side of First Departure, so I think they're setting up really nicely, even though they're, you know, a little bit behind on early CS.
Yeah.
Denied.
But this is a weird game because it seems like the, you know, the laning phase is getting you more kills by staying in lane compared to just rotating and going in the mid. But I'm actually worried right now for First Departure more because Ben-Hur, you see how he went for an Aquila before, now he's stuck with just the Bassy, which he probably feels he's more comfortable going straight for the Midas instead, and that means he's going to come online much quicker.
Yeah, it's, I mean, you know, one game one thing, another game another thing.
Yeah.
It's impossible to guess why, you know, that game he wanted to try the Aquila in this game he didn't, but... You're right, he's gonna go straight for the Midas or something. This is Thunder God's Wrath online now, and I half expected...
Hana. I think he dies here. Do they have one more stun? The Venomant here and the Poison Nova to follow. Invoker does kill the Ursa meanwhile. Oh, that ward, and Thunder God's Wrath. One more right click miracle. Actually, no, he's gonna die to the creeps instead. So a 2-for-2 trade. And thanks to this Observe Ward, it looks like they managed to scout out Polisson, who did die.
Yeah, what? I think he just died to Sunstrike.
Yeah,
I think they just saw him farming on low HP and he got Sunstrike.
That's really, really scary though. It's really annoying at the same time. I really don't like it when that happens.
I was gonna say, like, when you're playing against the Zeus, as soon as he hits level 6, you should expect the Zeus's team to try and make kills. And I thought it a bit strange when Esky went for aggression and Venno TP's and Zeus ulties, and obviously they get the win in that exchange. But it evens out just because the Ursa happened to be spotted by a ward. And it's a little bit unfortunate.
So First Departure have no interest in dewarding that. And now Mineski will probably look to try and play a bit more aggressive into the jungle. Oh, they'll find Lubby here. Scorched Earth, the mini stun coming out, body block attempt, not gonna be there. Raging Potato, he does get the enchant off as Polisson comes in. Impetus is gonna get himself a nice, easy support kill. And Mineski looking just kinda even here, First Departure. 6-5 at 8 minutes in, pretty okay-ish game. And the Zeus is very happy to just take his mid, chip away at it if you want a bit.
I think Mineski look a lot stronger outside of the ultis. Like, whenever Venno and Zeus have ultis, it's going to be favorable for First Departure in these fights. But in between them, I think Mineski actually look a lot stronger in terms of controlling the game.
Sunstrike, Golem, and Polisson just dies. It's the same combo again. And he's pinging out and he's like, guys, I think that's a ward. As the Lion dies and going to swap, Joel's trying to kill Miracle, who's going to try and juke him, but no, Venge gets to kill. Hana already using Chrono Spear, trying to rack it down Jules, but that's not the plan, and right now, Polisson's still pinging out their ward. He's like, guys, I need to get rid of this, otherwise I can't farm.
They used the Chronosphere to kill the support Lan, and they lost their Venomance in return. Definitely not a good trade for First Departure, and obviously also adding that the Ursa gets killed by the Sunstrike yet again. He's got to be really annoyed. He's saying, Zeus, just come here, deal with this, please. And here comes Wedding Crash.
On the bright side, he gets that Tiny Tater as well. Oh, uphill miss! Unfortunate. And bottom lane taking a bit of harassment is Lubby, trying to get to the level 6, and hopefully if he does get it by the next creep wave, he can be a bit more useful by setting up kills. Wedding Crash. What's his level at? Alright, he's level 8, Invoker's level 9, and the Midas is already there. And you can see a Yule Scepter almost completed by Ben-Hur.
Yeah, what do you know? Yet again, Ben-Hur is like taking the lead in the early game. It's just like, this player just always takes the lead in the early game, no matter what.
He's a player, man. It's just what he is. He somehow always finds his farm, which is really scary.
I mean, in this series, he's had like a pretty decent matchup every time.
Ana, Sunstrike to follow, and the Impale. Do they have a finger? Actually, no, maybe the Karakta came down here. Yep, the Vengeance Aura, level 3, 140 a click from the bench. Doesn't look like he hurts that much, but he actually does.
Yeah, so game looking good for Mineski. Like, really good, actually, I would say. And they probably are going to be able to assemble around the Vengeful Spirit and start pushing down towers soon. And they could run away with the game at that point, unless there's got to be a certain point where First Departure kind of put a roadblock in the middle of the road, where they win a big fight, or maybe they sneak the rush. Although, if you look at Mineski, they just plonk the creep in the rush pit, saying, "Ursa, you're not going to sneak in and rush." Well, the creep comes out now, but they're definitely aware of the threat of the rush.
And they will finish the credit of the top T1. Jules getting the last hit behind that as well. He's going to complete a Yasha, making his way to a Sanjin Yasha very, very quickly. And I mean, we talked a bit in the previous two games about how Polisson, he farms in the jungle, gets his items at reasonable timing, but he doesn't really accomplish much. So what do you think about this game? I mean, what else does he really need? Will the Vlads really help? Because I think sneaking a Roche is not going to be easy being on the Radiant side.
Well, I mean, if you manage to smoke in at the right time while there's a fight in the top lane or something like that, I mean, he needs a lot more. He's, you know, in the previous games I was saying his timings were good, but then didn't get as much as he needed to get done with those timings. His timings really aren't that good this game. He's been quite disrupted. He's still ahead of the Doom, but not that much.
Smoke from Mineski. I think they want to go for a kill here. Yep, and oh, that Chrono Death Ward doing so much. Ben-Hur not going to die here. He gets the Arcane Root and a finger from the line as the Zeus gets taken down. The Void gonna find himself a return kill, one for one trade. Time walks away all that damage, and Jesse Vash is gonna. Oh wait, actually no, sorry. Cast dies to the Ursa as Polisson finds himself the second kill of the game and places down the ward. So, all right, that skirmish a bit awkward, but I think that was an okay. It was a 2-for-1 trade in favor of First Departure.
Yeah, it's an overall win for them. It's something they needed, and they might get the Venge here too. Venge is gonna get caught, trapped in.
Oh, they're going for Jules. He's gonna get right click down, and look at the Enrage. The swipes, and Hana finding himself another kill. He died way
too big. It's very big. That's a carry Venge. That's not just like your regular support Venge kill. And this is the kind of disruption that First Departure need to Mineski's flow in order to put themselves back up there. And by the way, I just looking at the top lane, Jesse Vash went back and got an Iron Talon. He didn't have one at the start of the game, but decided actually he does want one. Wants to do a little bit of farming himself.
Iron Talon, really, really amazing item. And I think maybe he just gets it for the bit of value armor as well. I mean, with the Ring of Bassi, he's probably going for that Vladimir's offering. With that ward, he does scout out Hana, Sunstrike, and the Doom! He's gonna take a lot of damage here, I think he dies! But here comes Wedding Crash, looking for that comeback kill.
You can deny him.
Deny him.
That's pretty big. That's a pretty big impact for the Doom to have, actually. And again, it's the same thing happened last game. I really feel like Jesse Vash is a
Lubby
good mind for...
Kato puts on the death ward as well, but no, the coconut... Oh, the RNG was just so unfortunate. How did that not land on Raging Potato? That should have landed on him.
Yeah, I'm not too sure. But yeah, I was just saying, Jesse Vash, I think, has a very good understanding of how to make good use when he's a jungle Doom. Like, he's gonna get value out of all of his Dooms, and I think that's very, very important. It's like the exact opposite thing I said about Pillow, so where sometimes it felt like not getting full value out of his timings.
And the synergy, I just have to point out, I mean, it's something we missed a bit. The synergy between the Sunstrikes and Jesse Vash so far have been really on point. He's pretty much like the buff version of Azus because of the pure damage from the Sunstrike. It's really, really good.
Yeah. And Banho just hits all the Sunstrikes. I mean, it helps when the Doom can throw rocks at people, but he's hit some of that up there as well.
Radios. Oh, they're going again for him again, and this time the caskets will land, and of course the Maledict as well. Oh, but the nice double impale, and the Luther also is going to just clean him up. So, one cooked potato. Right.
What I'm wondering is, who on Mineski is going to buy a mech or pipe this game? Because these are items that you need. If you're going to fight against the Venomancer and Azus, you just have to get either a mech or a pipe or both. And I don't know, I mean, Doom went Arcane Boots, so maybe his plan is to go into Guardian Greaves ultimately. But I do think there could be a turnaround in a big fight at some point in the game. If there's no healing potential from Mineski, no damage prevention, and they have to deal with a full damage output from Venno and Zeus, once there's a Veil, once there's Axe Online.
That's about to smoke into the enemy jungle. They find Ben Hur. Do we have a death ward? Yes, now they will. And the Chrono Spear combo. Ben Hur, will he die here? No, the Yule Scepter and the stun. Lubby gonna fall down. And Ben Hur, Sunstrike. Can they kill Hana? Nope, won't get the time walk away. That animation. And Ben Hur, what looked like an amazing gank, turns around and he gets a double kill. So now his net worth continues to balloon.
Yeah, you gotta be careful about. So something a lot of teams think about is you should go for smoke gank when your allies are showing on the map, so it's not obviously smoke ganking. But it's also important where the enemies are showing. And they find Invoker easily in the jungle, but no one in Mineski was showing on the map, but precisely because they were all nearby in various parts of the jungle and just easily reacted to the gank.
Oh, look at how quickly this Roshan falls with the Wave of Terror, level 4 Vengeance Aura, and plus the Forge Spirits. This Roshan is 16 minutes in, it just goes down so quickly. And Ben Hur in ages now that you know that security so that he doesn't die so easily. Whew, this is just tough. I feel like first departure the time is slowly running out.
I still think there's a sweet spot they hit. One of them is gonna get a Veil, and Venno's gonna get Ags. And between Venno and Zeus the damage output is gonna be insane. And I think that outside of, you know, mech and pipe and BKB, Mineski lose fights to that combination. I think once First Watcher gets to that timing.
But you think it's a Veil? I think he goes for a Black Dagger first, right? Miracle? So that he can position a bit better?
Yeah, I'm not sure who buys the Veil. It could be Zeus buys the Veil, or,
oh, that's true.
Or maybe even just the support does. I'm just saying, at some point, their team's gonna have a Veil, and they're gonna have an Axe on there. Yeah, okay, so he gets the Blink to start with. He'll probably get an Axe next.
Yeah, they're gonna trade. They're gonna take this T1. But can they? The TP is coming in, and the double Welkin Tornadoes. I actually think the AoE of this tornadoes and these tornadoes are not accurate at all, because sometimes when you're standing like just a bit further away from what looks like the damage thingy, you're still taking damage from it anyways.
Oh yeah, their AoE is actually really big. You don't have to be like touching the tornado or anything like that. You have to be. They have like a few hundred around them, I think.
Yeah, I mean, I tried clicking on it. It's actually really, really big, so you can understand why people run away from it. I didn't know that until I tried it like a couple of weeks back.
Oh, Miracle getting in position, he wants to blink in, yeah.
Oh, but Holoson off ulti. The end range just in the nick of time. And I think they should go now, but they're gonna find Lubby instead. Just throw the death ward, gonna get instantly cancelled, and the finger! Jesse Vash somehow still alive, he's gonna get brought down by the Venomancer. And he still has his ult, with his big dagger, he wants to show it off. Can he? Pretty pleased is what he's saying, but Ben Hur gonna push away this T2. First departure, they need to make up their minds. Do they give away this T2? They already gave away a T1. And now the TP's coming in from Holoson. No, he goes back to farming again, and Miracle farming ancients or just staring. No, he's just waiting at the top of the stairs.
Okay, so Miracle's got a blink, and Wedding Crash has the blink, and Poloso has nearly got a blink. In fact, even the Void Wall, Void's gonna chrono the line in the lane.
Yeah, he's just dead.
And this Void's getting close to blink now too, which it looks like he'll probably go straight blink and not get the blad. So very, very soon I think it's likely that First Departure have 4 blinks online. They've got 3 already. If the Void wants to rush it, he'll be there soon, and even though they are behind in the game, you present 4 blinks, there's a lot of potential for anyone who's out of position to be very quickly and swiftly punished.
Oh, Ben Hur, he's gonna find Hana. Maybe it's Sunstrike? No, he's just gonna Midas away a creep, so gets away just in the nick of time. I think a Vlad would be better, since you have so many blinks already. I know, this is what I prefer, because sometimes I feel this is up to playstyle.
I think the blink is more important.
Jesse Vash. Have to be careful.
I think the concern is if he goes for Vlad's, he doesn't know how long before he finishes blink.
Miracle laying out Poison Nova ult. We have Wedding Crash, yep. Zelda's gonna clean him off, but Miracle, carry bench for carry Venno. The two star surprise heroes.
Zeus is gonna die too.
Yeah.
I think Zeus is also gonna die.
He's up in the air. Sunstrike media combo. Bam! And he just goes alive as Polo Saw in the bait! And with the enraged Fury Swipes, he's doing so much, but he has to run. Ben-Hur has a cold snap, off cooldown just only, and with the stun as well, Polisson is probably gonna die here, and Lubby lays down the death ward, but not gonna do anything. Well, looked like a surprise, but now the shockwave. Oh, what? Oh, taken by Raging Potato as Lubby has to heal up. And the tornado to cancel his TP, it's a 4-2 trade. Not worth it at all, and the double dooms walking around.
Yeah, so he does get the blink, there are 4 blinks, and I think they need it because you need the blink regardless, and if you buy the Vlads first, there's no telling in this game if he even gets the blink before the game ends. Like, they need to be winning fights to get ahead very soon. And you'll notice Doom, like I said, Doom bought the mech, going for the Greaves probably. So there's recognition from Mineski that the magic damage output is really high on the side of First Departure. And I think what First Departure need to do is abuse the fact that they have all these blinks and start catching off Mineski players when they're separated from each other.
Indeed, but it's just so tough because they don't have the damage. I would say the lockdown, not so much damage, it's just about the lockdown. Because if you look at the Invoker, I mean, back to the double kill when they smoked up trying to kill him, if they had a bit more, just one more disable, they could have killed him off. But the thing is, with the Yules and so many of the spells, with the Aegis, it's tough to really kill anybody at this point. Doom is tanky, he picks up a mech, like you were saying, and there's a Blink Dagger on cast.
Yeah, it's the lockdown, that's where the Void's Blink Dagger comes into it. I mean, he hits a nice Chronosphere, suddenly Zeus and Witch Doctor and Venom and so going to town.
Yeah, he did pick up the Blink, like you mentioned.
Yep. Jules is going to be rushing towards that BKB on Vengeful Spirit, that's also going to be really good against the magic damage, because ultimately, almost all the damage coming out of the side of First Apache is magic damage.
Jules, he's going to know that the Void is here. Alright, so meanwhile bottom lane, I think they want to go and pull us on again, who did get stunned, and the Sunstruck to follow, pops the Enrage, trying to run away, but the Yule Scepter, oh, he's just dead, one dead Fluffy Bear, and he will die. So Enchantress getting herself a lot of gold. It just seems like a repeat of game 1 and 2, I mean, except this time he's not getting the farm, he's not even doing much, and the T2's going away of the Enchantress. Oh, Hannah, they're gonna go on Jules. But he's just super tanky, 1600 HP, and Invoker's TPing in. The stop comes out, amazing Jules. Oh, he's just dead, but defense is void anyways. And Ben-Hur is suddenly surrounded by 3 heroes. Very, very scary. You should be very afraid as the TP's come in. He has the Aegis. Actually, no, it just expired a while ago. So it's going to be a 2-for-1 trade, and the 2 cores are down.
It's really good for First Departure. Really, really good. Remember Mineski's lineup, like, it's not really a scaling going late game lineup. In some ways, First Departure isn't either, especially because their damage is mostly magical damage. But I still believe that the sweet spot's going to be hit. I still think that when Miracle gets that Aghanim Scepter, that's going to be like a key timing for First Departure, and we're going to see what Mineski's response is the first time there's a fight with the Venomancer Aghs.
And he already had half of the Aghs completed. I would have thought a Veil would be coming up soon, but I think that should be up on Wedding Crash soon. Ursa actually gets a solo kill on the Lion top, so... Alright, Polizon showing he's not out of this just yet. We take a quick look at the net worth chart. Well, it's a nice comfortable 10,000 gold lead in favor of Mineski. I think Miracle...
Yeah, the concerning thing for Mineski though is that their strategy is not meant to like sit around and farm and get big. They get a Doom on Miracle, yeah, so...
I don't think he dies. This should be a strike. Kill. Ah, oh, he's dead for sure. Impetus cleaning him up. An exquisite
toxin. Yeah, so I mean, Mineski really wants to be sort of taking objectives, take rush, take engines, push, win game. It's not obvious that they lose if it goes very late, but I think they are like slightly unfavored, and it's not what their lineup wants to do. So every now and then, when First of all, you get a couple of pickoffs. That's like a bit of a question mark for Mineski because they don't want to be sitting around.
Indeed, but... Okay, I look at Venge. He has Manta, not less than Y. Probably a BKB next. First Departure probably will try to pick this top T1. And, oh, Ben-Hur is alone. This could be a trap. This could be a disaster. so much potential for disaster right here. Yes, are they gonna go? Actually, no, it looks like they will just find Raging Potato instead, and he blinks away immediately as they scatter around, and Lubby immediately looks for the TP out. So does Hana. So Wedding Crash, and alright, they're fine.
Yeah, I think maybe First Departure can go on Invoker at the start there, but they don't realize that he's completely alone, no one's ready to help him just yet. And yeah, I think they have to play it safe there, because if there's reinforcements, they could really just like throw themselves under the bus.
Alright, so 17 to 20 at 24 minutes in. We still don't have a clear winner, even though in terms of objectives, Mineski, they are the ones who have the upper edge, because they've taken every single tower except this mid T2, so all other towers gone, and somehow First Departure still able to farm the jungle very, very safely, which is a bit unusual. Yeah.
I would say Mineski are pretty far ahead. I just think that the defining moment of the game is going to be the first fights when Venomancer's Ags, because if First Departure can win that fight, then all of a sudden the game is a lot more even, it's anyone's to win. If Mineski are strong enough at that point to win the fight even through the Venna Ags, then goodbye First Departure.
No,
and we're getting there,
Yeah, I think they want to go for a kill, they want to force the fight here. But Hana positions himself all the way to side into the trees. Lubby, he's going to be the first one scouted out, and oh, Cass with a mistake blinks into the trees, but it doesn't matter, he still gets to shuffle his way out of there. And First Departure, they realize, oh wait, we need to back off, and the TP, yep, okay, so they do retreat, it's just Lubby who dies. So I think that was the best case scenario possible for First Departure. That could have gone way, you know, very, very much worse.
Yeah, Witch Doctor, Tank, or Smoke Gank, that's what you want. Venomancer are now getting 500 gold away from Ags, and pretty close to level 16 as well. But at the same time, the Doom did finish an entire Guardian Greaves, so there's gonna be a BKB on Venner soon as well, and I'm starting to feel like at the time the Venno gets that Ags in level 16 might be too little too late.
And the thing is, I would see it as a bit of a comeback item, but they just don't have enough items. Mineski, I definitely feel that they're comfortable enough. They want to take this T2, they can try and push for a side lane high ground. Unless they have one more item coming up.
It's really hard to push high ground against First Departure's lineup. Like, Zeus and Venno are two of the best high ground defending heroes in the game, and that's, I think, the inherent awkwardness in this game so far has been exactly that. The Mineski realize they're a lineup that wants to group and push, but once they get the high ground, it's definitely going to be a challenge for them.
I'm actually quite curious right now for the Doom. This is the first time I'm seeing a Greaves on the Doom.
Oh no, this was a thing for quite a while when Doom was popular before. It's as Greaves came out, it makes a lot of sense. I mean, as much as Mech Doom makes sense, obviously Greaves Doom makes sense, and they definitely needed Greaves in this game. He was the only person who could go for them.
Well, this is really annoying for the push. Okay, I think First Departure are quite confident about the high gun defense, like what you mentioned, and going up against the Supernova ult, which is almost level 16. Things look a bit more hopeful for First Departure. They just have to win, I think, two more team fights, and then Mineski will be on the back foot. Because right now, a majority of their gold advantage comes from all these other towers and the Roshan. Otherwise, if you take that away, I think the lead is not that significant for Mineski.
Yeah, I mean, again, the lead's big, but if they can't win the fight through the Venno level 16 Ags, then it's gonna be hard for them to win any fights, honestly. They've already got the Greaves, all they could get more is like BKBs or Pipe or something. Like, the way that they scale...
Oh, Octarine,
they
Roy.
Need to... I mean, I feel like Zeus or Venno, like, ideally, Mineski want to kill the Zeus or the Venno before they do anything, or Doom one of them, or Hex them with Lan. If both those heroes are just spamming out a whole lot of spells in the fights, the damage might just be too much.
Yex, Pollux on with an Invis rune, playing around. Maybe looks to go on the Raging Potato right here. Oh, now they catch him just at the very tip of the Chrono Spear. Nicely done in the BKB. I think they have the TP out right now. They have to run. Run for scout. Tornado comes out, trying to catch the Void. I think they do catch the Void. The Sponge Deck and the stun by Time Walks in just in the nick of time. As a Shockwave by Hana looks to be the only casualty here, and he's doomed up and the finger just to ensure his death. And with all those big ultimates gone, I think he's very happy about that, because without the finger and the Doom, they cannot challenge high ground again, which means more time bought for First Departure.
I think First Departure might even consider forcing a fight here. The Doom down, knowing that their Venomance and their Zeus are gonna get spells off, I think Miracle wants to go in.
Yeah, he does. He's looking for the opportunity right now as Banter throws all his combos on Wedding Crash. But if that's all the Octarine for the ult, Miracle, he get the kill? I don't think so. Venge should get the double kill. Miracle throwing out the ult of the BKB and Jules. Yeah, he's gonna get swapped back in, and this is 4 heroes down in Pulsan. Watch us from the river from a distance.
You know what happened there? The Benho has edges, and they were just like super confused because they really wanted, like, you could see that First Apache actually wanted to take a fight, but Mineski not giving them a chance to kill anyone except for the Invoker. Eventually they'd commit to the Venge, but Venge's BKB. And really just like almost outsmarting themselves First Departure, assuming that they'll get an opportunity to go for meaningful targets, and Mineski just don't give them any opportunity like that. And now it's not that difficult to go high ground when the Zeus and the Venomancer are both dead.
Look at the Vengeance Aura plus the Alacrity damage on the Invoker. That's 300 damage a click onto this tower. So it's gonna fall very, very quickly. But looks like they're gonna try to top, push it in a bit.
They tried to kill the Ursa, but he ulted BKB and he got away. It's quite a commitment, but it's actually quite good for First Departure. They hold all their towers. Mineski have to go back now, because there's the respawns coming.
Objective Gaming, this should have been at least a T3 mid down. I didn't think they could have left the Ursa alone.
Yeah, I think I agree with that.
Yeah, the situation now looks like it favors First Departure. Like you mentioned, you know, they at least to keep the tower. So I'm still waiting for the synergy for FD.
I mean, Mineski are still miles ahead in this game. First Departure have to take a big fight, and against the Greaves and the BKB and the Doom, there's a lot of tools that work against them, but we see that massive Chrono with multiple heroes, with the Ven ulti, with the Zeus. There's a lot of room for First Departure to win a fight. At this point, it depends on either being at their high ground, so the positional advantage, or getting a big Chrono, which also gives a positional advantage.
And Aegis is expiring in a minute, so I think that's when First Departure takes a fight. They have to time it correctly right now, because they're still in this game. But the ward's coming out from Mineski after point. Wow, this is very, very nice. I like this ward. It's such a pity. This is like one of those Nature's Prophet dream wards where you can just snap career right now.
And First Departure are split up. Their Void is nowhere near them, and if Mineski managed to smoke into them, it's not the fight First Departure wants.
Yeah, I think Mineski right now, they're looking for a fight. They would definitely want to take a fight. And it's Miracle, he's blocking off the path, using Banner Wards as Polizan immediately blinks and has to TP out. So they will save the situation as Jesse Vash looking for someone that blind guess, but it's not going to be enough. And now, First Departure, they will just back off. So they dodge a bullet, or actually several bullets for that one, and they buy themselves more time. Still no Veil in sight. Yeah. I mean, Wedding Crashes had plenty of Octarine Core. Is that really the right item?
It's pretty good sustain. It makes the hero very difficult to kill. Gives him better damage outputs. I think it's quite good. There's a debate amongst pro players that I've heard. Some people don't like it, some people do. Some people say Refresher Orb's just better. Must point out, if you look at the net worth, there's two heroes right at the bottom. This game has like 8 cores. As we said, both teams had a jungler. And then there's the poor Lion and Witch Doctor at the bottom, but the Witch Doctor is substantially behind the Lion, who, you know, Lion has a Blink and a Ghost Step, that's all the Lion needs. Witch Doctor still has pretty much nothing, so it's really hard for Labby to have a big impact on these fights.
Oh,
at the same time, if he manages to, it could be, like, really big.
Courier killed by Polison. Did you see what was in the Courier? I think that was a Hex almost completed for somebody.
I'm not sure. What did it say? I didn't have it hotkeyed, but
875.
Yeah, it sounds like a Void Stone or something.
Yeah, that is a Void Stone and Ring of Health.
Although, aren't they 850 these days? I feel like they changed.
Oh yeah, it is 850.
Yeah, so that can't be it.
We're
supposed to, I mean, we're just unprofessional commentators. You're supposed to like hotkey the career and then you can check.
Wah. Oh no, disaster. Alright, so item progression again. I mean, all these items up for First Departure, we talked about the Ags and all that, but how do you think they win a fight right now? Because Mineski is just so far ahead.
Miracle's got his Veil. I mean, it's like, it depends on either fighting at their high ground or getting a big Chronosphere. That's what I've said before, and I stick to that. Like, I think the damage output is fine if they got the control elements, but the control elements is either a positional advantage at their base or chroning like 3 or more heroes. And I think Mineski realized that. So Mineski are kind of like the balls in their court. They have to open themselves up to a situation where First Departure could win a fight. Unfortunately for them to win the game, they ultimately have to do that anyway. So it's some kind of risk when they push, and they're gonna have to just watch their positioning.
Right.
They're gonna go back and kill the Rosh first, I'm pretty
Yeah.
sure. And
And if you look at Jules, he almost has a butterfly completed, so. Well, actually, if anything, after this Rosh, he is gonna have it completed, so this is really, really big for them. And there are no MKB carriers in sight, not on the Hana, not on the Ursa, and they're so reliant on this Venomancer. I believe this was supposed to be something like a snowball kind of strat for First Departure. Because I'm still waiting for that really, really sweet team fight, which would be really amazing for them. But it doesn't seem like they're getting the shot, because Mineski have been playing this very, very well, and forcing them to play passive. So, Zeus, if you.
Mineski have been very deliberate to not give First Departure the fight they need.
And now you can see 3,000 gold on the Zeus. The buybacks, he is the only one on First Departure with buyback. Everyone else in Mineski, you receive the Venge and the Invoker and the Doom. The other ones are buyback, so it's okay. As long as the Corsair buyback, I think they can actually throw themselves into the fight for this one. Just like push for the high ground. But once again, they're just playing very, very safe. You can see Hana anticipating a gank top, so he hides all the way in the trees.
Yeah, well, First Departure almost hoping at this point that Mineski will just push their base already and give them opportunity to position for a fight. Mineski have got the Aegis, they've got, I believe they've got Cheez now as well. Is that right? Yeah, they've got Cheez and Enchantress. But they're still just, biding their time, recognizing they can extend their lead. This is like classic LGD style. Just extend, extend, extend. If you're worried about breaching the high ground, the enemy team has a good high ground defense. Keep extending your lead. And if First Departure get angsty and impatient like this, come out of their base, Mineski end up winning a fight outside of the base, suddenly it's very easy for them to push. So First Departure needs to be very careful when they do leave the base in these expeditions.
So by starving them out, I mean also I think that Mineski, they want to force First Departure again. And Paulson with another Invis rune. I mean, back to my point, I wanted to point out is that I think this is right now it comes down to the mind games, but maybe not. Mineski could be looking to go here. Paulson just cutting the creep wave. All right, Zeus, just zap this creep wave down. The golem there.
Mineski actually showing signs of committing to a siege, and it's just watch their positioning. See, do they ever stand close enough to each other to get caught in a chrono with multiple heroes?
Just
Because
knocked up. Jules looking for the swap, and there we go, the Blink Doom on Hana. He is there's no chance for a Chrono Spear. And it's a very, very long swap, and Polson's gonna kill off Kaz, and the Zeus ult's gonna come down. Jesse Vash, the Greaves keeping them alive. Polson, BKB and Enrage being baited out as the Raging Potato, he's gonna just blink away. Oh, that Butter Potato and the Sunstrike, Polson's gonna get just brought down by the Invoker as Ben-Hur. Crazy. There we go, Jules. Happy with this, he's just gonna just spawn again, second life,
Although,
and do a reset.
the Chrono and Venna ulti combo is still available, so Mineski needs to be careful. Actually, the Ursa nearly killed the Enchantress there. Took out the Lion, almost killed the Enchantress. If he'd gotten both, it might have been a really good fight for First Departure.
And now Mineski just back off. I think they're feeling more and more nervous because First Departure, I think they're gonna be more confident as well. And there we go again, another Crimson Guard coming out on Jesse Vash on this Doom. He really likes this item, so that's a lot of physical damage being heavily negated by, especially from the
I mean,
Ursa and Hana.
it's not, I mean, actually most of the damage is not physical, but it's just a good high
Yeah,
grounding item. You
it's still
just
good.
get all the high grounding items you can. I think they'd probably rather have a pipe, but it's gonna be okay. It's actually a good hold. I mean, it just shows the strength of First Departure's high ground defense. The Void gets doomed, can't do anything. They still managed to get rid of the Aegis, take out the Lion, and almost kill the Enchantress. Their team is just really ridiculously good at defending high ground.
Jesse Vash not gonna have a Doom for 40 seconds, so maybe this is the time to fight. And they're waiting for Polozon again, and there we go, he's gonna be up in 5, and the Zeus ult comes out, and the Greaves keeping him healthy. Raging Potato falling very, very low. Where is the Miracle ult? It's there, but it didn't really attach it to
He
Ben-Hur.
missed. It missed. It missed everyone, I think.
Yeah, and oh, there we go, Hana again. Polozon going crazy. He's gonna pop the BKB going on Jesse Vash, as Hana gonna get fingered down by the Lion. And Mineski going for Jesse Vash. Alright, everyone else from Mineski will just retreat. First
That would have been,
hold.
I mean, First Departure win this fight without Venno ulti, because he first ultied and then he blinked in. I don't know if you saw that. Like, I think it's like he just like miscued his, like he pressed the wrong hotkey at the wrong time. He ultied the
Picking up
ground
by
and blinked
Polozon.
forward.
Yeah, that's a casual Sunstrike, but I think this gives Mineski more reason to worry, because like you mentioned, if they can win a fight like that without Poison Nova, then this just makes things very, very difficult for them. But it should be noted as well that the Doom did not use Salt.
Yeah, but right before that, they also held when their Void was doomed. Like, each time under difficult circumstances, First Departure still hold the high ground, because their lineup is just that good at holding the high ground. And it is maybe cause for concern for Mineski, who still hold a huge lead, but don't have a very clear route for taking the high ground. I honestly think that the best opportunity for Mineski will be that they get to take a fight outside of the base, get some key pickoffs, and then they go. If they have to push First Departure's base with everyone on First Departure alive, it's just always going to be very difficult.
And we're going to see 3 minutes before our next Roshan, and once again, I mean, yeah, I totally agree with you, Scans. This game is just not easy for Mineski to break the high ground. And at the same time, there's just so much growth as Polisson now. 3.6k could go to an Abyssal or maybe a Hex of his own. And if he keeps on farming, this game is just going to get so much more intense. And First Departure, the net worth. Yeah, everyone's just starting to slowly climb, maybe except for Lobby. You know, he's just left for support. Dirt poor.
And because the Venno and the Void both have Aghanim Scepter, it's super short cooldowns as well. So even when they miss, there's not that much of a window.
This
60 second cooldown on both big ultis and...
Yikes. Alright, so... Polisson splitting out the top. Maybe gets a T2.
Zeus now has a Lincoln, so difficult to doom or swap in, difficult to catch out.
I actually think
and Void smokes around. This is a chrono attempt.
Oh yeah, they want to fight this. And they do get the range racks. Venom Ward's not going to do much. As Polisson gets the top T2, I think they're perfectly okay
comes
with
the chrono.
Chrono coming up, maybe. Oh, Benho with a beautiful deafening blast, and the chrono only catches two in the back. And then Invoker, he's going to kill the Venomancer Miracle and force to buy back Ursa. Oh, now going to get soft Jules. Gonna kite Polisson, who does not have a BKB. He just can't see so many heroes, and now a Miracle ult's only gonna land to Jesse Vash, and the barracks coming up for First Departure. And now Mineski, they will have to back off happy with the objectives, but here comes Raging Potato. Oh, he's gonna kill Miracle again. This is a dieback. And Zeus does get the Doom. Polisson gonna try and kill the Raging Potato. He likes his carbs, he's gonna get it, and Jules, oh, you're in the wrong neighborhood. And he's just gonna keep on going as Wedding Crash, gonna throw out all those kills, and the deafening blast once again from Benho, just beautiful. Always catching all this out, and Jules, he's very, very low. He's gonna be the first one down. And now Benho, yeah, he's the Oxbeam Core. They're gonna try and find it, but no, they can. Can they get a bolt? No bolt, no bolt. 4-4. I think that was a 4-5? 4-6?
Yeah, the weird. I mean, this is. There were a lot of buybacks on the side of First Departure, and I think that this is still a win for Mineski. They get Raxes, sure, they lose a lot of heroes, but it is both the Ursa and the Venno that bought back, I think, and. It's funny, but I think almost because the Void was sneaking around to get a nice chrono, it works out that Mineski had this approach of we just jump in straight at you. You know, it's a totally different approach. Beforehand, they always had this, let's stand back, split up, and try and avoid the combos.
He's gonna find himself Lobby. He's gonna get another solo kill, and the Sunstrike doesn't even need it. Just 3 cold snap right clicks and he dies. So Lobby is not having a good game. He's 3,800 gold net worth. And, I mean, I also want to point out that Benner, he had a very, very good deafening blast. It was almost as good as Ravage right there. He took out 4 heroes. Chrono's Brief, gonna catch the car. Jesse Vash pops the Crimson Guard and Kyle. He's gonna be forced to time walk away, and now in First Departure, will just back off using the BKBs and Rage everything, and not even gonna get the kill. As Hana is forced to time walk, TP not yet cancelled. He doesn't have a blink yet. He has to blink out now. Yes, he will. He's gonna time walk and TP out, so he just completely jukes. Actually, maybe not. The tornado's gonna cancel the TP. And there we go, Benha, finding another tasty, tasty boy. Sunstrike again, he's dead, stomped on the spot like a bug. I guess
you're more like Benha making all the plays. This guy is just an absolute machine. What a Dota player.
It's just...
And Satanic will be picked up on Vengeful Spirit now, so even more tankability.
And you can tell Polisson, he's trying to make his way to an Abyssal Blade just with the extra lockdown. Oh, Wedding Crash, this is not the play. Miracle lays down his ult, but the BKBs apart from Benha. And Wedding Crash waiting. He's just waiting and waiting and waiting. Lays down the ult. Maybe Death Ward gonna just zone them back a bit, but I think Mineski are happy at this. Polisson, he's looking for a bit more. Beautifully gonna kill the Raging Potato and the Bear. He's gonna get doomed up. Miracle does not have an ult. It is on cooldown. And he just caught in a tree that he's gonna get fingered down. Invoker gonna get the last click, so the only one in buyback is the Void. This could actually be the key to go to the bottom lane of Rax.
Yep, it's the buyback advantage. It's what they finally got. And I mean, it was scrappy for Mineski, but they managed to kill the Venom without buyback, and they know it, and this is go time.
This is not good, and right now you can see all just swap Polisson back in, doesn't have a BKB, the Lincoln's trying to save him there, but he doesn't even get to pop his ult, and he does not have buyback for over a minute, 100 seconds without your bear, no miracle as well, and Mineski going to take game 3, Sunstrike, ready crash, they have to hold, I don't even know how, and this looks like GG to me, Scans.
Yeah, and I gotta say, I thought Mineski looked shaky in the first two games of the series. I thought they looked a bit shaken mentally, actually, but this game they've had the patience, they've had the composure, they knew what they had to do, they avoided
the
top.
Three mad Chrono! First departure, no death ward. You have a Zeus ult, not for 4 seconds. And Redding Crash, this is the final stand, he will just die here, forced to buy back. And they're gonna go for Jesse Vash, who's just taking on in the front line. And Zeus is gonna kill the Raging Potato. And Joe, look at that right click damage! Oh, he doesn't even care. And the death ward's gonna come out, it doesn't even matter. Ben Hur, still alive. Hana, oh, just the deafening blast again. And the time walk, the follow. Death ward, full duration, cast still alive. And Ben Hur just gonna ban one Redding Crash, and he finally goes down. 1,500 gold going to be a miracle, but Ben Hur will buy back. He wants to end this now. Yep, he's back into the frame. Yeah. He's gonna keep on going to cold snap. Hana, gonna time walk away. And that's
what,
top lanes of
rap. One time we finally see like a really big Chronosphere, but no one's alive to dish out the damage.
And there we go, Ben Hur, Alacrity. This is probably gonna be Megas right here. I don't see Redding Crash coming. He already used buyback. Polisson's still waiting for the sidelines, miracle.
One last Chrono,
oh,
one last Chrono.
On. Chrono on 3, and that's it! This is the final stand cast, and the ult gonna go on Jules alone, but Jules pops the BKB. Lion forced to buy back Jesse Vash, gonna go on Miracle and Hana as they don't have their spells anymore. Everyone's just dead useless, and this is Mega Creeps and Venge, just one reckless bringing down the Red Doctor and the Doom on Hana, fingered immediately, and he's just gonna die there. Now he's gonna be forced to buy back Miracle. They're going for Miracle. Oh, he's dead. Ben Hur is dead, this is a dieback, so first departure, unless you just go straight top lane or bottom or mid, I don't know, something, and cast Go Scepter, getting kited around, and it's Stomp again. Polisson gonna get a comeback kill. Jules, time walk away. This is the part where you just like, we're just gonna kill whoever we can and then call GG or something like that. Or do they actually,
it's a dieback for Lion and Invoker, so they might think they have a chance to go. Yeah, look, the arrow's drawn because Lion and Invoker both can't buy back. And if ever there was a chance to just go, it's when two very important utility heroes are dead. Everyone else is going to be able to TP in. Well, Witch Doctor will have to run. Zeus is going to be able to respawn, push out some creeps a bit, and then TP in.
And if you look at, okay, Jules, he has buyback still. It's okay. So, and the thing right now is first departure, they don't have these very strong push heroes. So even if you get T2, you're definitely not getting lane of racks, and least of all, you're definitely not getting the throne. There we go, Jesse.
Well,
Vash.
They gotta try. They gotta try.
Polisson. Look at how tanky.
Chrono.
Oh, the Chrono, but the synergy. He just messes it up. And now someone's TPing in. I see Miracle. Raging Potato. Alright, they're gonna keep on going. They're gonna wait for the BKB to expire and then kill this Potato. That's right in the base. Wedding Crash. The lone defender. This Jesse Vash gonna kite around Polisson. Dude's out, comes out. And now we see. Actually, Witch Doctor goes down. But it doesn't even matter. Face is probably gonna get himself Potato at last, and Jesse Vash. Now, is he gonna die? No, he's just kiting them around like monkeys. What?
Like monkeys? Is that... Yeah, Doom's dead. Doom doesn't have buyback. Invoker's gonna be up soon, but doesn't have buyback. Enchantress does not have buyback.
Yeah, Miracle's desperate to
There will be an Invoker and an Avenge. And Avenge will have buyback.
Yeah, this is the death push right now, because he bought the Deso.
It is possible. I think they could do it. Zeus has to stay back and defend and TP in at the last minute, maybe. Like, if Zeus were to leave the base, the creeps would just kill the base far too quickly. So it has to kind of be there for as long as possible.
Oh, they're going here. Time walk. Miracle, no, not like this, not like this. Sunstrike, oh, he's just gonna die here. And the finger. Oh, time walks away all the damage. And the Chrono Spear on 3. Miracle doesn't have it all. And Hana's just gonna die here. He doesn't have buyback. Miracle is just gonna try and wreck someone away. He's gonna blink out. Maybe just buy a bit of time. And cast. Oh no, he cancels the TP. Why? And there we go. He's gonna just
kill.
He's just
gonna
now.
Get disabled.
Desperately baiting around, and they will find Miracle at long last. That Venomancer is finally gonna fall. Two heroes down, and no buyback on either of them for over a minute. And everyone else in Mineski just starting to come back to life. So, comeback, really? Not really. Just kidding. And Mineski, looks like they'll close off game three in what you call intense fashion.
Yeah, the dream is dead. Unfortunately, they didn't have their cooldowns. Despite the fact that Ben Ulti is 60 second cooldown, it just wasn't ready at the same time as the Chronosphere. The Zeus couldn't be there. It's just so much. It's really difficult. If they were having these kind of fights when they still had one Rax up, totally different story. But the way they're forced to play against Mega Creeps just makes it that much more difficult. And Mineski on top of what they need to do.
Radiant's middle
Oh,
tower
your
is under
Venge
attack.
clicks like a truck. 450 damage DPS coming out. And there goes Wedding Crash. He's gonna get caught by Ben-Hur. Here comes the Meteor combo and the Deafening Blast to fall. He's definitely dead right here as three heroes down. Hollows on the Witch Doctor against the world. I think they call it here. Lovey, he's given up. Oh, he's just waiting in there. Holosan, he's just happily standing between four heroes, not that happy after all, and he will die. So this is game three, going the way of Mineski, 2-1. They will face Fnatic tomorrow. Skance, what are your thoughts on this game?
I'm impressed by First Departure in this series, because I expected them to... I didn't expect that much from them at all. And they gave us a cracker of a series. Mineski, I had doubts about actually in the first two games. They looked a bit shaken, but this game I think they played particularly well. I think they kept everything together, they made the right moves, they didn't force the issue before they needed to, they waited to have all the right tools. And obviously, again, I'm going to say it for like the millionth time, Ben-Hur is a fantastic player, and he's had another fantastic performance. Some very key Deafening Blasts, some very key players all over the game, and Mineski I think probably deservingly go forward in the tournament, but First Departure is a team that maybe people should, you know, pay attention to going forward. They maybe want to be able to diversify a bit. I think if anything, it's probably a weakness of First Departure if they're going to have to always run a jungler every single game. It becomes a bit transparent at a certain point.
Indeed. So, alright, this is the end of our series today for the Epicenter C Winners Bracket Games. And my name is Hades. You can find me at hades.tv on the social media platforms. And of course, you can find Scancer at Scancer. And I'll link it out back in Twitch later on. And of course, thank you, Scans, for casting with me. Will I see you tomorrow? Hopefully?
I'm not too sure yet. Yeah, but hopefully. Hopefully.
Hopefully. So thank you all for watching. And
yeah,
yeah, this is the end of the games for today. So see you all tomorrow. Good night.